Lorenzo Paña was a community organizer. Aldrin Enriquez was an activist, both human rights defenders, and both are now dead. The latest victims in what Rights Group Karapatan calls the killing spree of human rights defenders under this administration. Joining us now, Cristina Palabay. She is Secretary General of Karapatan. Hi, Cristina. Welcome to the program. Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year. Glad to be with you again.
All right. So tell us about the circumstances surrounding the deaths of Mr. Lorenzo Paña and Aldrin Enriquez. What can you tell us, Cristina?
Well, Lorenzo Paña and Aldrin Enriquez are both human rights defenders, and they're both red tag. Enriquez was among the farmers who were red tag in Bohol. The same with the circumstances of Mr. Enriquez. But on the 30th, just when Paña was murdered, there was also this series of killings in Capiz, in the island of Panay, where 9 indigenous leaders, many of them are barangay officials, and they're considered also human rights defenders, have also been killed. So what we're saying is that the killings of human rights defenders alongside the killings in the name of the war on drugs have all contributed to a climate of impunity where no one, literally no one, has been held accountable.
Cristina, when you say these two men were red tagged, by whom and how did that happen?
Mm-hmm. Well, they were red tagged by the local soldiers, the local commands of the military and the police, and members of the police, no, both in Camarines Sur and in Bohol. They, as individuals and their organizations, have been included in the streamers, posters, flyers, which were accused as fronts of the CPP and PA, just like in the killings of Sara Alvarez, Randy Echanis, and other human rights defenders who were killed.
So their faces were plastered all over the communities they were in?
Yes.
And these posters were put up by?
Well, most of the posters were put up by civilians, no, but these posters are being referred by local commands of the Philippine Army and the Philippine National Police whenever they go around forums in schools, in workplaces, or in communities. In the case of Aldrin Enriquez, he was actually facing a complaint, no, a murder complaint. When he submitted a counter affidavit during the course of the preliminary investigation, mm-hmm. Saying that he was not there during the said incident, alleging that he's a member of the New People's Army. And then all of a sudden, a warrant of arrest came out to him. So he was actually being served with a warrant.
Mm-hmm.
When he was accused of being of fighting back or nanlaban.
Right. Cristina, in your statement, you released a statement, and in that statement you say state security forces are terrorizing civilians to squash dissent by murdering and silencing activists, human rights defenders, dissenters, and government critics. What makes you think that these two deaths that you just spoke about are part of this?
Well, for one, Carmina, the it's very easy to connect these cases because, for one, even if we say that these are being, you know, red tagging is very commonplace right now, right? And even celebrities or public officials are being red tagged, but at the community level, its impacts are more disastrous, no? Such as these cases. So we are referring to the instances when they were red tagged before these individuals were killed, no? And they have no known enemies at the local level except that they were accused by the military or the police of being such, no? Mm-hmm. Being supporters or members of front organizations, alleged front organizations of the New People's Army and the CPP. So, kumbaga wala kaming maisip, no? Wala ring alam yung mga pamilya nila na dahilan para sila patayin o may kalaban silang iba na magme-merit ng ganong klase ng paglabag sa kanilang mga karapatan, kanilang buhay, except that they have been at the crosshairs of state security forces at the community level.
Tell us about what effect might this have on other dissenters, on those who do criticize this government?
Well, as for one, the chilling effect is real. Precisely because if you're an activist or a community organizer or anyone who wants to express their thoughts, opinions on social issues, you get a sense of fear because you see that people who are speaking out are being killed or arrested.
Have you seen this, Cristina? Have you felt it? Have you seen this among this fear, this what you call this chilling effect, Cristina?
Oh yes, you know, because many human rights defenders, understandably so, no, because of fear for their lives, would tend to, you know, think twice on even posting or even airing out their opinions on issues. So, in a sense, it silences your freedom of expression of your thoughts, no, hindi lang yung aktivismo mo. Kaya it's a dangerous effect because it not only silences dissent, it silences your exercise of critical thinking, no? And in the current state of affairs in our country, especially when we need watchdogs during the time of the pandemic with the various government policies we are faced with, it sends a dangerous signal for democracy.
This administration, as you know, Cristina, is entering its final year. Do you think, though, that it will stop then? The killings will stop then, once Duterte steps down? What do you think?
Well, Tamina, unfortunately, we are not quite that optimistic, especially this year, no? Because of the state of affairs, because of the worsening climate of impunity, as we say, no? Literally, no one is being held to account. But at the same time, we're also hopeful that there are many mechanisms that are hopefully will work, you know, like the international mechanisms that human rights defenders are accessing from the Philippines, such as the UN Human Rights Council, the International Criminal Court. Of course, all these are dependent, you know, on how the people, on how civil society, on how communities can, you know, really push for accountability. These are dangerous times, you know. We know that, you know, and we hope that that protests will certainly be galvanized, especially against the killings, kasi sobra na, sobra-sobra na talaga.
Incidentally, when you speak of dangerous times, a thought comes to mind, and that's renewed efforts to tinker with the Constitution once again. What are your thoughts regarding that, Cristina?
Well, the there have been numerous attempts to amend the Constitution. I mean, even if really our Constitution needs to be amended to ensure that the integrity of the country, the sovereignty of the country is, you know, protected at all times, there is a need to look at the motivations behind these recent efforts. Mm. Is this another effort to prolong themselves in power? Are these efforts for the benefit of the economy, especially at this time during the pandemic? Are these efforts meant to stifle and to further constrict the democratic spaces that we have right now? With the recent proposals, including the possible abolition of the party-list system in the recent Chacha proposal, I don't think it's a priority or it's needed even, no, for our country to have this kind of constitutional amendments.
Cristina Palabay, Secretary General of Karapatan, nice to talk to you again, and you keep safe.